As long as you're in it, the story's not finished. I know you've overcome, so I know I'll overcome. As long as you're in it, the story's not finished. I know you've overcome, so I know I'm gonna overcome with you. As long as you're in it, story's not finished. I know you've overcome. I know I'm gonna overcome, yeah. As long as you're in it, well, the story's not finished. I know you've overcome, so I know I'll overcome. Oh, let that breakthrough, a miracle, the power pour out. The cross stands before me. It is finished, it is done. Yeah, I heard you told death it was over. So in your name, I'll claim this fight is won. Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Oh, we live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. We live for you.
Good morning and praise the Lord, everybody. Amen. Why don't we all stand together? It's so good to have all of you here with us this morning. I pray that you have had a blessed week. And my goodness, I was tuning in last night late to our Mississippi District Youth Conference, a motion conference I had down in Madison. And amen. There's just a hunger in this generation for an outpouring of the miraculous. Amen. And I come to church today expecting God to do a great work in this service today. If you need a touch from the Lord today, I believe today is a great day for you to receive that. Amen. And I know I'm not naive to think that everybody's had just a great week. There might be some of you here today, you've had a bad week, but you're in the presence of the Lord now, and the joy of the Lord is your strength. Galatians 5:22 said, but the fruit of the Spirit, everybody say of the Spirit, is love. And then I like this next one, everybody say joy. Joy is something that we all need to live our life with. It's not always going to be a happy life, but we can always have a joyful life. And the church said amen. Romans 14 and 17, Paul said, the kingdom of God is not meat and drink, but righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Ghost. Anybody have joy today? Now, since everybody didn't say that, I want to just tell you today, you can have joy before you leave today. Amen. You say, well, Pastor, if I could just have some things to make me more happy, I'll have joy. It's not like that whenever you're living for God. Amen. We pursue after the joy of the Lord because it's not in us that our strength is anything, but His joy or His strength is made perfect in our weakness. Amen. And I want Him to have His way in my life today, don't you? Amen. Anybody want the joy of the Lord to be your strength today? I believe with all of my heart that the joy of the Lord can fall afresh in our life today before we leave. And if you need the joy of the Lord, we need to get this in our spirit today. God, before I leave, I'm going to leave with your joy. Let's worship the Lord this morning. To declare that this morning. Oh, yes.
There is no devil that can come against me. I've been blessed, I've been bought, I have been set free. I feel the joy of the Lord falling fresh on me. I feel the joy of the Lord delivering me. I feel the joy of the Holy Ghost.
Tired of it playing with your life.
I deserve better. I won't go another day. I'm here to claim deliverance in Jesus' name. I feel the joy of the Lord falling fresh on me. I feel the joy of the Lord.
Anybody got a testimony today?
I feel the joy of the Holy Ghost all over me.
Thank you, Jesus.
I have been loose. I've been set free. So pardon me a moment while I have a jubilee. I feel the joy of the Holy Ghost all over me. Pardon me a moment while I have a jubilee. I feel the joy of the Holy Ghost all over me.
Come on, He's worthy.
I feel the joy of the Lord falling fresh on me. I feel the joy of the Lord delivering me. I feel the joy of the Holy Ghost all over me. Pardon me a moment while I have a jubilee. I feel the joy of the Holy Ghost all over.
just worship Him for that joy today. Come on, it's the joy of the Lord that's my strength. Thank you, Jesus. Come on, joy doesn't come from receiving, but joy comes when we begin to give God praise. If you'll begin to lift Him up, He'll begin to let you experience His joy today. I see praise. I see worship. Come on, I believe that all of heaven is rejoicing today. Thank you, Jesus. This is a day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice. I will be glad in it. And somebody say amen. Amen. Remain standing if you will. Brother Wallace, if you've been making your way up to have our ministry minute today, it is so good to have all of you here in service with us. It's good to have the Lord here with us. I feel His presence here today. It's good to have Christy Shaw with us. It's Bryson's mom. Amen. So it's such an honor to have her with us today. Amen. All of our guests, thank you so much for coming. It's good to have my hands with us today. Thank you so much for being here. Amen. This is Nick and Serenity's parents, and it's good to have them with us today. And God is so good, and He is so faithful. And there is no weapon that's formed against the people of God that's going to prosper. How many of you believe that? So that means whatever you have brought to service today, you can leave free from. If you'll give it to Him, you can leave free from it. And so I challenge you, before you leave today, cast all your cares upon God and see that He cares for you. Amen. Brother Wallace, come and share with us a ministry minute today.
Praise the Lord, everybody. Anybody come to worship the Lord this Sunday morning? Anybody expecting a miracle to be able to happen this Sunday morning? Amen, amen. Deuteronomy chapter 1. Pastor, thank you for giving us this moment that we can share the Word of God. And I felt this. And if God does something, give Him praise. But if it fails, tell Him Jerry Wallace did it. Because God never fails. Deuteronomy chapter 1, verse number 29. Then I said unto you, dread not, neither be afraid of them. The Lord your God, which goeth before you, He shall fight for you, according to all that He did for you in Egypt before your eyes, and in the wilderness where thou hast seen how that the Lord thy God bare thee, as a man doeth bear his son in all the way that you went until you came into the place, this place. Yet in this thing you did not believe the Lord your God. You may be seated. Thank you for standing in reverence to the Word of God. In this scripture here, Moses reminded the Israelites of their march from Horeb to Kadesh Barnea. And through this, that great and terrible witness wilderness they went through, he showed them that near that they were at a happy settlement near Canaan. They was near. They could see over. And you know something? How much more as you and I today can we see over what God's already doing? There's a Canaan. This world's not our home. We're just passing through. And I believe one of these days, and soon and very soon, we're going to see the King. I entitled this Fear Not. Now, what is fear? It's unpleasant, often strong emotion caused by anticipation or awareness of danger. And not, no way, Jose. It's not going to happen. I think all of us here should have our minds made up. We're not going to give in to fear. Because in recent years, we'll find that Americans has become engulfed in the fear of the point of allowing those fear to override every day. Let's think back in our history. December of 1999, it was the Y2K. What is this? This was the idea because the computers was invented in the latter part of the 20th century that no computer was designed to go beyond 1999, and they were going to be shut down at midnight of 2000. That would have been great chaos, wouldn't it? For those who joined Social Security and different retirements, it was going to be chaos. It was a disaster, but guess what? Nothing happened. Let's look back in December of 2001. Followed 9/11, there was a very real fear in American culture over Islamic terrorism. Western civilization has dealt with this fear all the way back to the 7th century A.D. And its ebbs and its flows we find all through those centuries. Sadly, we saw that the fear come to fruition in the very vivid way in 1911 as a very fear that continues to this day. Fall of 2008, leading into the new year of 2009, there was a widespread of fear in American culture over the economical meltdown, if you please, that occurred September of 1908. First, Lehman Brothers went bankrupt, followed by many other brokerages and financial institutes that went bankrupt. This meltdown, it feared the America. Pandemic had hit 2020. But let me tell you, as people of the faith, children of the King, Jesus' followers are not to let fear overwhelm them. The Word of God says, fear not, O land, be glad and rejoice, for the Lord will do the great things. We are called to walk, not in fear. Pastor's been preaching and teaching. Everybody's been talking about fear. But we should not fear in any way, form, or fashion. Isaiah tells us, fear not, for I am with thee. Be not dismayed, for I am thy God. I will strengthen thee, yea, I will help thee, yea, I will uphold thee with the right hand of my righteousness. As the scripture said, I read you in the first verse, it said, dread not. The word dread means don't fear. Don't be dismayed, because God would direct the children of Israel, and he's going to direct you and I likewise. Do you believe the Word of God? Do you trust the Word of God? I do, because when all is said and done, it's only through our faith in Jesus Christ we can have victory. It's only through him, for whosoever is born of God overcometh the world. And this is the victory that overcomes the world, even our faith. Fear not, he's with us always, even until the end of the world.
And the church said amen. Amen. As he was talking about that, I was reminded, he talked something about Y2K in 1999, as the year was turning over to 2000, I was assistant manager at the skating rink in Tupelo, and we had a lock-in that night, as we did every year for New Year's, and it fell my lot to work that night. And we just came up with a plan. We got kind of bored, and we said, you know what? We're going to, at 12 o'clock midnight, we're going to shut the power down on this place. And we're going to scare these kids half to death. And so we started making announcements as it got closer. It's almost 2,000. And we'd talk to some of them coming around, you know, what do you think about this Y2K? And so we were setting the stage for when the moment happened that it would just captivate them. And, but the reality is the power never was gone. It's just somebody went to flip the switch. What are you saying, Pastor? I'm saying that wherever you are in your life tonight, it's not that God's power is any less today than it was before. It's not that God's ability to heal you is not any less than it was before. It's just that for whatever reason, somebody has allowed the enemy to go back and flip some switches on your faith. But if you can just put your faith back in God and just let faith be a lock on that switch box and say, devil, you're not going to have access to those switches to where you're making me feel like I'm good one day and down the next day, but greater is he that's in me than he that's in this world. Amen. And I want to tell you, the power is still available. Ushers, if you would come, prepare to wait on us for our Sunday morning tithing and offering. Thank you so much to this church family for your faithfulness in giving. We had a business meeting this past Wednesday night, and God has been so good and so faithful to our church family. Thank you to those that were able to come Wednesday night. Amen. For those that wasn't able to come, amen, I thank you for trusting us that everything is well. And amen. But we do pray that God will continue to bless our church, bless our mission in this city, in this community, and I know that he will. Amen. Brother Kenny, would you bless our offering today? Amen. As you're giving, let me make some announcements. Again, our secret sisters are putting gifts out on the information table in the foyer, and so be sure to check that each service, and that will help us keep that table cleared. And then everybody say tonight. Tonight at 6 o'clock we have church, and we would love for you to come and be with us. Come early for prayer at 5:30. Practice today at 4:45, and we would love for you to come and be with us in service tonight. Ladies Zoom Bible study is Tuesday night at 7 o'clock, I believe. And then midweek Bible study, 7 o'clock Wednesday night. And we'll have Bible study here in the sanctuary for our adults. Our children and youth will be upstairs in their respective rooms having children's church and youth service. And then Thursday morning, our ladies have prayer at 8 o'clock in the morning. And that evening, we have Bible quiz and practice at 6:30. And I believe this week, I'll touch base with Sister Tina to find out for sure, but I think we're having Bible quiz and practice Tuesday night this week as well. And that would be at 6:30. And then this weekend is another busy weekend. And I want to say thank you again to our youth and all those that were able to go to our Section 1 youth services this past weekend. Just a great outpouring of the Lord in those services. And I know many of our people were touched in those services, so I give God praise for that. We do have some fellowship coming up this weekend in the section. Our Section 1 Ladies Fellowship is Friday night at 6:30, and that's at Pleasant Hill in Corinth. Sister Stephanie Parkey is going to be speaking. And then the next morning on Saturday at 9 a.m., we'll have our Section 1 Men's Breakfast. That's always a great time. We wasn't able to do it last year because of COVID, but we are looking forward to coming together with the men of our section. Brother Bill Parkey is going to be speaking at that. And we do need to have a count, so if you can let Brother Eric or myself know tonight, if you're able to go this Saturday, that will help us turn in a count, and we can get that taken care of. Looking ahead, we have revival services with Brother Jeremy and Sister Jamin Hart on March the 21st at 10 a.m. and 6 p.m. They were with us not long before we completed our remodel, and they're going to be back with us in a couple of weeks, and he's going to be singing. Both of them will be singing and preaching in that service, and so you definitely don't want to miss that. Easter, everybody say Easter. Easter is right around the corner. Can you believe it? Just a few weeks away, the first Sunday in April is Easter, but the weekend of that or before that, on March the 27th, there is a community-wide Easter egg hunt at Westside Park, now known as Plumrose Park, and that's going to be from 10 a.m. to noon, and we certainly invite all of our church family. Let's go, amen, be a witness and be a part of that, but take your children, your grandchildren, and let's have a great time of fellowship in our community. And then our Section 1 Kids Rally is April the 1st. That's a Thursday night at 7 p.m. at the Central Church, and we're going to have children evangelist Kevin Merriman, and so we are looking forward to that. I tell you, my wife and I, we missed being here last week, and but what a great move of the Holy Ghost. I watched the services and stuff this past weekend, and that past Wednesday night, Brother Eric Boren blessed. It was with Bible study. But aren't you thankful the kingdom of God is just so much bigger than just one person? Amen. That his will being done is bigger than just one person. Amen. We did have some birthdays coming up this week. Tuesday is Adam Nichols has a birthday. And then Friday, Brother Ricky, I think we got it right this time. This Friday is your birthday, and so happy birthday. And then Saturday, Brother Kerry McVeigh has a birthday coming up, so we celebrate with them. And then before we sing this next set of songs, I know we haven't had an opportunity to really hand out our baptismal and Holy Ghost certificates this year, but I want to do that this morning. For those that's already been baptized and those that received the Holy Ghost this year. And so I'm going to call these names out. And if you would, if you can make your way up this way, Hunter, before you said, I want you to come on up here. You and Ashley, both Hunter and Ashley, baptized this year already. We give God praise for that. Amen. Rayshawn, is he in here this morning? He got baptized this year. Give God praise for that. Bryson, come on up here, buddy. Bryson baptized in Jesus' name this year. Amen. Amber Lambert, won't you come up here? Amen. All these been baptized this year. Amen. Nicholas, he's up in Children's Church, I believe, but Nicholas, my hand, was baptized here. Give God praise for that. And then, Bryson, don't go too far, buddy. Because that Tuesday afternoon, God filled Bryson with the Holy Ghost right there in the baptistry. God's done a great work in this young man's life, and we're so proud of him. Amen. Isn't God good?
Love you, man.
Amen. And then also, Katie's not here today, but God filled Katie Oathalt with the Holy Ghost. Amen. On that Sunday morning, as we were just closing service, she said, I want the Holy Ghost. And amen. If you're hungry today, God will fill you today. Amen. So don't leave the same way that you came in Jesus' name, because no matter where you are, his love can come down and rescue you. There's no pit that you can fall in that God cannot rescue you out of it. Amen. If you're thankful for the love of God, can we just all stand right now, lift our hands in worship, and let's worship him in song again.
Though I cannot see.
next part's important. Confident to say that today.
Love your word, God. Loving the word and hating the dark.
Great I am, the great I am.
Come on, can we lift our hands and worship Him? God, You are holy. You are wonderful. You are marvelous. You are glorious. Hallelujah. How many can testify that You know there is no one like our Lord? There is no one like Him. Amen, amen, amen. We're going to go to the Lord in prayer right now as we prepare our hearts for the Word. We want to continue praying for Sister Catherine, Sister Ruth. Amen. As they are going to be going this week to the service of their sister. Amen. We'll pray for safe travels and pray that God will keep His hand upon them as they travel this week. Amen. Their family, Sister Faye, I saw you back there. We continue to pray for Sister Faye that God would touch her in a great way. Amen. We pray that God would touch Brother Randy today, that God would minister to him. Amen. Brother Harry, we could just pray for complete healing. Amen. Sherry, I saw you come in back there. We're praying for you. Amen. It's good to see you at church today. Amen. Praise God. We want to continue lifting up Mike Hopkins in our prayers. Sister L.A. and her family. Amen. The Pierce family. Continue praying for the Copeland family that God would touch them. Amen. Their family has been hit so hard these last several months. And there are other needs that I know that are represented here today that God needs to move in. And we are believing that He will. We want to lift up Brother Arliss in our prayer today. I believe, is he in Oxford now, Brother Lambert? He's in Oxford at the VA. And we want to continue praying that God would touch his body and strengthen him. Let him feel what he feels when he comes to church in that VA room where he's at. And I just know that God will let him do that. Continue praying for those unable to come to church because of being in a home. Sister Shirley Isbell, we'll lift her up in prayer. Sister Audra Cook, I'll lift her up in prayer. Sister Ellen Allen, continue praying for her. Brother Johnny Lindley, we want to continue praying for him. And so many needs. Sister Elaine, I'm glad you're here today. Praying that God has continued to touch you. Amen. Is there any other needs that like to be represented by an uplifted hand? How many of you know God's able? Amen. Can we pray right now for these needs and then pray that the Lord would let His Word speak to us today? God, You are so good. God, it's not by accident, Lord, that anybody is here today, that anybody is watching online today. God, but I believe that You have a perfect plan in place. I pray, Lord, that You would help us to be sensitive to that today. Lord, that as You move today, Lord, that we would see Your hand at work. God, that there will be needs met today. Lord, there are people that need healing in their body that are represented here today. God, and we're proclaiming, Lord, that these signs shall follow them that believe. We believe You for it today. God, every need, Lord, every person, Lord, that can't come to church today because of being in a nursing home, God, in a hospital room. Touch Sister Anita today, God. God, I pray, Lord, that You administer healing to her body. We thank You, Lord, for where she's already come to. But, Lord, we're going to continue to praise You and believe You for complete healing in Jesus' name. Come on, do you believe that? The Lord's already started working, but we're going to claim a complete healing today. God, You are so faithful. Touch Rhonda today, God. Minister in her life and her body, God. God, I believe, Lord, that Your Word will accomplish its work in Jesus' name. And the church said, amen. Amen. Stand, if you will, for the reading of the Word. Amen. The Lord is moving in this place today. And yesterday afternoon, as I was preparing and finished preparing for this sermon and what God, I believe, has to speak to our church today, there was an overwhelming sense of something great's going to happen. And so I just believe God for that. Amen. And I can't get it out of me. And we are in these last days. And I'm not saying that to scare anybody. That ought to give hope to the believer. Amen. But we have an opportunity to see the former and the latter reign together in our midst. Amen. That's where we are. And so that's a reason to rejoice today. Amen. 1 Samuel chapter 14 and verse number 4. 1 Samuel chapter 14 and verse number 4. Amen. Between the passages by which Jonathan sought to go over to the Philistines' garrison, there was a sharp rock on the one side and a sharp rock on the other side. And the name of the one was Bozez, and the name of the other Sina. The forefront of the one was situate northward over against Michmash, and the other southward over against Gibeah. Verse 6 said, Jonathan said to the young man that bare his armor, come and let us go over to the garrison of these uncircumcised. It may be, somebody say maybe, that the Lord will work for us, for there is no restraint. Somebody say there's no restraint.
And these next three words is where this no restraint is connected to. Because if we're talking about us, there's restraint. But the Bible says there's no restraint to the Lord to save by many or by few. Amen. But Jonathan told his armor bearer, he said, come on, let us go over here, because it may be that the Lord will work for us. And I want to preach to us today from this thought, moved by a maybe. Moved by a maybe. They didn't know for sure, but they moved anyway. They didn't know what would happen if they responded to what their situation was, but they said, you know what, let's go somewhere. Amen. And all they had was a maybe, but they were moved by that maybe. If you're going to help me, you can be seated today. Amen. So good to see all of you here. It's a great turnout on this Sunday morning. Praying for our children today that are in children's church, that God would touch them in this service. And the church said amen. Our text that we just read, it described that Jonathan had found himself between two rocks. The way that I would like to describe that this morning is this way. It's more familiar to us. Between a rock and a... Anybody ever been there? You ever found yourself in one of those areas where it was a rock on one side and a rock on the other side and just like, what do I do? And if we were to be honest, we would all have to testify at some point, maybe even this morning, of finding ourselves in this same area, but not only in the physical sense, but in the spiritual sense. You ever felt like it just seems there's something trying to stand in the way of what God is wanting to do in your life? You began to feel like your prayers are never going to be answered? We're going somewhere. It's okay to be honest today. And God seems to be too busy to hear your prayer. You ever been there? Am I talking to anybody today? Am I preaching to anybody today? The reality is that is a very dangerous place to be, because the outcome is going to be determined of how you and I approach that situation. I don't know what Jonathan was thinking in our text this morning, other than the fact that he wasn't sure what the outcome of him stepping out onto the battlefield was going to be. And I know that he felt that way because the Bible says in our text that it may be that the Lord will work for us. So Jonathan didn't know that he was going to have victory. Jonathan didn't know that there was going to be victory on the other side of him being willing to move, and whenever maybe nobody else would, but he would be willing to step out in faith. But what he did know is that if I sit right here, nothing is ever going to happen. If I just stay the way that I am right now, nothing is going to change in my life. And all he had was a maybe, but yeah, he was willing to move because of a maybe. That's all he had. He didn't have any surety. He had faith. And this morning, amen, I believe that there's going to be people leave. Before you leave today, that you're going to be willing to step out. And you come to church today and you don't know what tomorrow holds, and you don't know what's going to happen with this, and you don't know what's going to happen in your finances and with your health and with your loved ones. But before you leave today, somebody can say, but if the Lord be for me, who can be against me? I'm willing to get out and move on a maybe anyway. Amen. So, in the Old Testament, whenever God wanted the children of Israel to move and he wanted to resituate or to reposition them, they didn't dare move if God wasn't moving. They waited until God gave them a sign, or he told them to move. In Exodus chapter 40 and verse 37, it says, but if the cloud were not taken up, they journeyed not till that it was taken up. Numbers 9 and 19, it says, when the cloud tarried long on the tabernacle many days, then the children of Israel kept their charge of the Lord and journeyed not. They watched for the cloud, and they would move with the cloud. And Numbers 9 and 22 says, or whether it were 2 days or a month or a year that the cloud tarried upon the tabernacle, remaining thereon, the children of Israel abode in their tents and journeyed not, but when it was taken up, they journeyed. So when God moved, they moved. When God spoke to them, and when God showed them, and when there was something inside of them and they could see that God is trying to push me and God is trying to lead me somewhere, Trying to help somebody today to let you know that God's trying to reposition some of you. God's trying to bring some of you to a new place, to a new walk, to a new commitment. And if somebody would just be willing to step out and forget about what the outcome may or may not be and just say, God, if that's you leading me, I'm willing to step out into the unknown and I'm willing to go places that I've never gone before and experience things that I've never experienced before. And so God would, he would move the cloud at different times and he would show them that you go from here. And the children of Israel, they used this ability to discern when the Spirit of God was trying to move them to get to where God was taking them. And one of the most important lessons that it taught them was, don't you ever get too comfortable where you are. And in 2021, I want to challenge us, we better not get, if 2020 taught us anything, we better not get comfortable where we are. We better not get comfortable just kind of going with the flow, because the flow may not always go. Oh, but if we're always just dependent upon the flow, it might just be you and me that needs to open up so that what needs to flow can flow, and so that the Spirit of God can move, and so that the Spirit of God can work. But we can't get too comfortable. And so God would change the time of day that he would move the cloud, and to teach them that no matter comfortable or convenient where you are right now, this is not the place that I promised you. You're in the wilderness. There's a greater promised land that's coming for you. He didn't tell him when he was going to move. He didn't send advance notice. And it wasn't because he didn't love them. If God doesn't just show a big old bright light to you and say, this is what I want you to do, and this is why I want you to do it, and this is when I want you to do it, it's not because God doesn't love you. It's because he's already given you his word. Oh, my. And if we're always looking for a sign, we may miss him. He's got it right here. He is the word. Amen. He didn't want them to be comfortable. He didn't not come and tell them in advance because he didn't care about their uncertainty in their life. God knows how you feel. God knows the battles you face. He knows the uncertainty that the enemy would try to use this season to try to grip your heart with. And yet he still leaves it to us to follow him and to watch for him. He still leaves it to us to choose to be in a state of readiness for change. If we want greater outpouring of the Holy Ghost, I promise you God's ready to give it to us. If we want miracles in our body, if we want people to be baptized in Jesus' name, I promise you God is always ready to save people. And God is always ready and wanting to deliver people from where they are and the life that they're living. He's just wanting people to move. And one of the greatest battles that we'll fight is that of the familiar. Because we get so accustomed to things being one way. This is true in every area of life. If you're a manager and you got an employee that's always done one job, and you try to move them, it's like pulling teeth. Even though they're well capable, and I don't know how many is in production, but I don't know if they're starting to cross-train people. And it's not so much that these people aren't doing good at one job or not. It's because somebody don't need to get too comfortable and being entitled to one little thing, because it might be that they're needed another day to fill in. And so that whenever one person's out, the whole thing don't shut down. And we understand that at the factory. But in the kingdom of God, it's the same thing. Amen. I was confident whenever I left last week that even though the pastor was here, that people were still going to come to the house of the Lord and there was still going to be a move of God. Because we have to understand, it's not just about, well, I'm entitled to this, and so this is all I'm going to do. But God, I am available to you. So if you want to use me here, you can use me here. If you want to use me here, you can use me here. I don't know what it's going to look like. I don't know if I'm ever going to get the hang of it. But God, I'm willing to step out on the battlefield. If you're prompting me to move in my spirit, if you're prompting me to get out of my comfort zone, if you're prompting me to seek you for the Holy Ghost, even though I might have been taught all of my life there's no such thing as the Holy Ghost. But God, if there's more for me in your word, if there's more for me as I live for you, as I seek you, then God, pour it out in my life and use me. And depending on your experience, all you may have is a maybe. But can you be moved by a maybe? Because if we're not careful, we'll let things that become familiar to us become something we're comfortable with. And then in our flesh, we fight against anything that tries to push us out of our comfort. And many times moving is difficult because we leave the familiar. It's the same in a worship service. As we worship God, amen, it's all right every now and then just to worship God in a way that you normally don't worship God. Just to, amen. Hebrews 11 and 8 says, by faith Abraham, when he was called to go into a place which he should receive after for an inheritance, he obeyed and he went out, listen to this, not knowing whether he went. A 75-year-old man. Say, Pastor, my season's already passed. When you got faith, the season's never gone. Because Abraham at 75, we left and went to a place he didn't know where he was going. He went into an area of ministry with God that he never. And God's looking for people that will follow him into the unknown areas of life. But God, I just don't know. I just don't know how that's going to affect my life. I just don't know how that's going to affect my relationships here on this earth. And we got to be like Abraham and say, God, I'm just going to obey you. Just going to obey you. God's looking for people that will follow him. Isaiah said, I will bring the blind by way which they knew not. I will lead them in paths that they have not known. I will make darkness light before them and crooked things straight. These things will I do unto them and not forsake them. If you're willing to walk, God's willing to lead. And if you're willing to follow after God, God's willing to clear a path for you. And he'll make those crooked things straight before you. Well, Pastor, if I can't see around the curve. It's not up to us to see around the curve. It's just us to trust God. And as we continue to walk, those crooked things, you'll be able to look back and say, God, that thing that was crooked before me, you made it straight. God, that thing that was uncertain before me, you made it all work out for good to them that are called according to your purpose. Amen. So I want to be willing to move even when it doesn't make sense. To obey even when it looks foolish. To obey what everything natural in me says, stop. Sometimes it's just a maybe. But what we need in this hour is more Holy Ghost-filled people who are desperately seeking, God, what is your will for me? What is the way that you want me to go? God, what is it that you need of me? And God, God deliver us from decreasing desperation. We cannot be comfortable where we are right now. We cannot be. But when there's a level of desperation, God, I want to go to a new height. God, I want a close walk with you. God, I want to see my family saved. God, I want to see my church prosper. God, I want to see your kingdom prosper. God, I want to see my loved ones come to an altar and repent of their sins. God, I want you to renew your spirit in my life. I want you to renew a passion in my life. Staying desperate for you, God. We're in the end time, and we can light up the world for Jesus Christ. But if we spend all of our time trying to go through life and replace all the high energy, high wattage lights with these energy efficient bulbs in our relationship with Christ. Say, Pastor, what do you mean? You don't pray like you used to. Don't seek God like you used to. I have watched over the last 8 years of pastoring as people come from outside of the church, they come into the church, and you can see God do a great work in their life, and God delivers them from things in this world, and they're in the altar every time we have church. But as God delivers, as time passes, there's a decreasing desperation. And I'm not putting all the pressure on the new people, because as time passes, what they do is they watch saints of God that's been in the church for years, that they say, okay, I guess, well, after I've been in church a while, this is how I'm supposed to worship, and this is how I'm supposed to be faithful. And I guess since they don't come on midweek worship, I don't have to come on midweek worship. And I guess because they don't lift their hands and worship anymore, maybe I can graduate to a place where I don't have to worship Him like I did whenever I was so grateful God delivered me out of the... Well, because they don't come to an altar whenever it's an opportunity, then I guess since I'm saved now, then I don't have to go to an altar. I'm trying to help us today. I want to sound an alarm in somebody's life today that there don't need to be decreasing desperation. There's a burden in me. God, baptize us with a fresh passion. Baptize us with a fresh burden. Baptize us with a fresh desperation for God. We want more of you. Come on, there are serious things going on in people's lives right now, and they don't need a group of people just coming together and just clapping our hands and just saying, yeah, we went to church today. But they need people of God touching the throne room of heaven and saying, oh God, touch this wicked generation that we're living in. Oh God, deliver them from depression. Oh God, deliver them from the things they are addicted to in this life. Oh God, deliver them from perversion. God, let there be a freedom in the atmosphere. And when there is a spirit of desperation, God can work and God will move. But whenever we just get to the place where we say, God, okay, you've done it for me and now here I am, but there can never be that place where we just get comfortable and just sit down on God. God has said, will you still serve me? Will you still worship me? Will you still live for me? Will you still be faithful? Will you still seek me with your whole heart like you did when you were on the bottom in this world? We want our children saved, and yet we're not faithful half the time. We want to set an example. Pastor, I want to see my family saved, but I won't worship and I won't show up to church. We can't talk out of both sides of our faith. And the church said, amen. We've got to adopt the attitude of those four lepers sitting outside of the city when they asked themselves, why sit we here until we die? They didn't know if they were going to be healed. They didn't know what was going to happen to them. All they had was a maybe, but they were willing to be moved by that maybe that was in their life. They understood that if they stay where they stayed right now, that nothing was going to happen that's any different than what's happening right now. Well, there's people here today that need the Holy Ghost. There's people here today that you need to be delivered from what you're going through. And I'm telling you, if some saints of God would touch heaven right now with your worship and with your expectancy and get out of your comfort zone and begin to worship God like your eternity depended on it, because eternity is weighing in the balance today. You say, Pastor, I don't know. I've done that for years, and sometimes it happens. And some, all you may have is a maybe, but if somebody would be willing to just say, God, I'll move. I'll be moved by this maybe. Come on. There's another leper in Mark chapter 1, verse 39. He preached in their synagogues throughout all Galilee. He cast out devils. The Bible said in verse 40, there came a leper to him, beseeching him and kneeling down to him and saying unto him, if thou wilt, thou canst be made clean. And Jesus moved with compassion, put forth his hand and touched him and saith unto him, I will, be thou clean. And as soon as he had spoken, immediately leprosy departed from him and he was cleansed.
This leper had to get past the point of what everybody thought about him. He wasn't even supposed to be there. He wasn't even supposed to be in the midst of where they were. But yet he got beyond what people were saying about him and the person that people said he was supposed to be and about the places that people said he was supposed to be going. And he was found beseeching God. If somebody today can get beyond what you've always thought that you was going to be the purpose for your life, and you can get beyond what people have put a label on you, and you can get beyond about, well, I'm just here today by accident. You're not here today by accident. God's appointed you this place. And if you will beseech after God today, if you will seek after God today, you'll find him. Oh, somebody say amen. Can we just give the Lord a hand clap of praise right now? Come on, God's trying to minister to somebody's heart today. God's trying to reach somebody today. We're in that series right now on Wednesday nights about degrees make a difference. And we talked about how that all started with the psalmist. He recognized about all the power of God. He knew about the power of God. He knew about the ability of God. But yet at the end of the day, he had to say, I'm like a lost sheep. I've gone astray. And this leper, he's in the same situation. He knows all about the power of God. This leper, he beseeched him. He's saying, Lord, you will. You can make me clean. He knew what God was able to do. And much of the frustration that we get in our walk with God is that if we really have faith in God, then we really know what God is able to do. We got to know. If we know how big God is and we say we know who God is, then we have to know he's able to do anything. But the problem is that we're so full of information about him and very shallow on our intimacy with him. God, I know you're a good God. I know you're a faithful God. But the reason why we get frustrated is because we're not willing to get close to him. Because if you get close to him, your life will change. If you get close to God, there might be some callings that he calls out of you. There might be some positions that he calls you to. If you would just get close to him. Oh, when it comes to being healed, when it comes to being changed, when it comes to being delivered, there has to be somebody that's willing to say, God, I want to do more than just know about you. I want to do more than just know you, but I want to be intimate with you, God. I want to be close to you because a touch only comes through that intimacy with God. That leper knew if God would, that he definitely could. And the Bible said he beseeched him. He knelt before him. The Bible says in verse 41 that Jesus moved with compassion, put forth his hand and touched him and saith unto him, I will, be thou clean. That touch from God is where the miracle came in. That touch is where that breakthrough came in. But there was a decision that the leper had to make before the touch ever came. He had to beseech after God. He had to find himself at Jesus' feet. And whenever he was willing to go to Jesus' feet, before Jesus was ever moved with compassion and touched the leper had to come to him. In other words, the leper would have never had his healing. You're here today, you need the Holy Ghost today. You'll never get the Holy Ghost if you never come to God. You can know it's real. You can know it's for today. But if you never come to God, you're never going to get it. But if you'll beseech him, if you will seek him, he said that we must know that he is and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. He wants us to seek him with all of our heart, mind, soul, and strength. Even though our carnal minds just puts us in a place where, well, because I've done that before, and nothing happened. I don't know that God will do it this time. Here's what I can tell you. That it's impossible for God to lie. So it can be in this service. It could be tonight. It could be Wednesday night. It could be at your home. But here's what I do know. You will never be touched by God if you're not willing to come to God. You will never get your deliverance if you're not willing to seek God. But how dare this leper come to Jesus? Does he not know who he is? I can see it now. Like so many times we can be so guilty of whenever we see people come in that maybe not just be just like us. Why are they at church today? They're not making any changes in their life. They're probably drunk right now. Let me get close enough so I can see their eyes. I bet they're still high. And I've come this morning to tell you that that is the perfect place that this is the perfect place for you to be today. If you're addicted to stuff, if you need to be delivered, if you're bound by the things of this world, if you're lost, you are in the perfect place today, because this is a place, it's a safe place for you to seek after God. And we're not going to judge you, and we're not going to condemn you. Jesus said, neither do I condemn you. You just go and sin no more. There can be an altar of repentance found for somebody that's willing to be moved by maybe God. I don't know what tomorrow holds, but right now I've got an opportunity to respond to your presence. Because a leper was willing to come to Jesus, it was somebody that Jesus was willing to touch. Oh, the church needs to say amen. Come on, we need to be like this leper. And realize if we're going to receive a blessing from God, if we're going to be caught up to the next level in God, the next level of our potential, then we're going to have to learn to admit who we are and just come to Jesus. Can we just lift our hands right now? Come on, God, let there be a desire in every one of us today. God, that we want to be touched by your presence, Lord. That we want to be touched by your wonder-working power today. Let your blood run in this service today. I want to encourage somebody today, because in our minds, that's where we struggle. How could this perfect God, this awesome God, this saving God, how could he ever love somebody so imperfect as me? How could he ever forgive me after I have failed him time and time again? I have lived for him and I have walked away, and here I am again. How could he ever promote me again? How could he ever use me again? How could he ever forgive me again? I can't all explain all that to you other than his word says that he loves us with an agape love. It's an unconditional love. And we have to understand that God's not looking for perfect people. That'll help a lot of us. Any of you men like to go hunting? I enjoy it when I get to go. I just don't get to go. I've been maybe two or three times since I've been in Boone. But I enjoy going. You know what you're willing to do? Set for hours. I don't want to gross nobody out, but you will take a jug with you and a tree stand so you don't have to climb down all day. And you will do that every day, every afternoon that you can. After you get off work, you'll do it if you got time in the morning, and if you like some people I know, you'll go hunt before church. On Sundays, but how many times have you sat out there all day long, from dark to dark? Because I know nobody hunts after dark. But you sat out there from dark to dark and not ever shot a thing, not ever seen a thing, and still go back again. You don't tear your hunting house down because you go out there a day and you don't see anything. Because you know the location. There's some tracks. There's some signs of some bucks in this area. And so you will sit up there all day, not see a thing, and go back another day. You know what that is? That's you being moved by a maybe.
Anybody like to fish? I know y'all got some fishermen in here. Mm-hmm. Now, I'll be honest, I can't fish all day if I'm not catching anything. I got about 2 minutes. And then I got to go to the house. But I do like to fish. But some people can sit out there on that boat, have that little foot on that trolling motor. All day long in the sun, beating down on, God forbid, in the rain. Just stay all day, have to wash the boat, clean up all the equipment, put it all back up, get it all out again and go. And you may go multiple times, never catch anything. You don't go selling your boat and throwing away your fishing rods. And you know what that is? That's you being moved by maybe. So why is it? Well, ladies like to go shopping. I won't buy anything unless I find a good deal. And so you go and you don't find a good deal. That happens rarely. God really moves in that area. We start liking in church to shopping, we'll be in good shape. But you'll go, say, if I get a good deal, I'll get it. If it's not on sale, I won't get it. And you go again. You don't just never go to that store again. You are being moved by maybe. So why is it whenever we come to church and God is prompting us and God is moving us to respond to His Spirit, and you're going to be touched today. But you've been touched before. But I still struggle with these cigarettes, and I still struggle with the bottle, and I still struggle with this, and I still struggle with these feelings, and I still struggle with this. And so is God really working in me? I want to tell you that God is still working in you and that God is still drawing you, but you're going to fight. Don't throw away the church and don't throw away your relationship with God just because you don't find everything that you want one time. Now, we're moved by maybe all the times in the natural. But when it comes to the spiritual, we also have to be willing to muster up faith in us. Because if we're ever going to accomplish anything great, well, I've invited them to church before. You invite them again. They'll come. I've tried before, Pastor. Well, try again. Amen. If we're not careful, we'll get so caught up in pleasing people and being an excellent person that we forget our purpose, which is just to simply do God's will. It's not about being perfect. It's not about being excellent. It's about doing the will of God. And that's the best that you can do on this earth. Is God, whatever your will is for me, that's what I want to do. And by the way, that's the best you can do. Do God's will. Do God's will. Because living a pleasing lifestyle to God, it goes beyond living an excellent lifestyle, but it's all wrapped up in living an obedient lifestyle. So if you're living in obedience with the Word of God, you're all right. There's no room for compromise. And too many today are asking the question, how far can I go and still be called a Christian? Instead of saying, how holy can I be to please my Lord and my God? It makes a difference. As we all stand, God knows right where you are. And He knows every battle that you're facing in your mind, in your life. He knows what you're facing on the job. He knows what you're facing in your family. And yet He still stands at the door. And just,
I just wonder, is there anybody under the sound of my voice that's willing to say, okay, God, I hear you, and I'm willing to come to the door. God, what is it that you want from me? God, what is it that you're desiring of me? What would happen if men and women of God would just start, amen, lifting up our voice and just start lifting up a shout of praise and saying, God, I do believe that you are more than enough. God, I do believe that you're more than enough to save my family, more than enough to heal my body and to deliver me out of what I'm going through. God, I believe. What would happen if some of our dear saints right now will begin to pray for backsliders as if their eternity was coming up? Amen. I just wonder what would happen if every time that we come together, people would just have the frame of mind that this might be our last service. This might be our last opportunity to really get our minds focused upon the things of God. What would really happen if we would just start praying right now for some people that might be here that need the Holy Ghost and believing that God's going to prick their heart today? That God's going to fill them with the Holy Ghost today. Come on, if you're here and you've never been baptized in Jesus' name, today's a great day to move out and say, God, what is it that you want from my life? God, I want to be sensitive to what you want from my life. Maybe, just maybe, God's Spirit will begin to fill this room. Maybe, just maybe, God will begin to pour out the Holy Ghost in this place. Maybe, just maybe, somebody can leave and testify, God, you delivered me from all those feelings of depression, of suicide. God, you've delivered me from this backslidden place that I've gotten myself in. Maybe, just maybe, God will work when we begin to move. Help us to be moved today. Come on, he wants to touch you today, but he'll never touch anyone that's not willing to come to him. Hell will be full of people in eternity. Not full of people that God didn't want to touch, not full of people that God didn't want to deliver, but full of people that just didn't want to come to him. If you're willing to come to him today, he's willing to help you today. I want to challenge you, no matter where you are, no matter what kind of load that you're carrying, come to Jesus today. Come to Jesus today. Anybody tired of having your back against the wall? Anybody tired of just sitting there between that rock and that hard place? Come on, Jonathan's, where are you at today? Why would we just stay here? It just may be that the Lord will work for us, for there is no restraint unto the Lord to save by many or by few. Come on, the God's not limited today. Somebody needs to let the devil know, I'm not letting you have access to the switches of my faith anymore, the switches of the power of God in my life anymore. I know that there's still power. There's still wonder-working power in Jesus today. Devil, you're not going to fool me any longer. I'm not going to fall prey to your devices any longer because I'm not ignorant of them. But I'm going to let my faith stand. Don't let the devil convince you to stand still on that maybe. But let the Lord draw you to move. Be moved by that maybe. The Lord will work for you today. The Lord will work for those that are willing to come to him. As they begin to sing, I wonder if we could just seek God right now. Oh God, I know that you are. God, that you are a rewarder of them that diligently seek you. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for every promise, God. Thank you, Lord, for what you've already done. But, Lord, I know that you've got greater things in store. Thank you, Jesus. Come on, I wouldn't leave the same way today. Oh, there's a purpose for your life. There is a purpose for your life. Hallelujah. God, let there be hope given today, God. God, let there be somebody, Lord, be renewed in their understanding that greater is he that's in us than he that's in this world. God, to be renewed in their faith today, that no weapon formed against them is going to prosper. God, that no matter what the enemy has tried to make them feel like, a loser, Lord, a failure, God, that they can be renewed, they can be washed, they can be restored in you today. Jesus' name.
I want to sit.
God, we want to be close to you, God.
Drink from the cup.
Lord, if you're willing to draw close to Him, if you're willing to beseech Him today, He's willing to touch you today. God, I trust you. I'm believing you, Lord. I'm believing you, Lord. In Jesus' name. Thank you, Jesus. Come on, it doesn't matter what your history is. He can wash you today. He wants to wash you today. Oh, there's people that know you, that there's going to be a testimony of God's deliverance, of God's healing. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. God, I don't want to leave the same way today. I don't want to leave lost. I don't want to leave broken today. Yes, God. Touch today, Lord. Minister today. Hallelujah. The more.